Greetings in the name of the Most High, Yeshua, the One, the Lord, Yahweh Elohim, God, the creator of all things, sustainer of all things, and I suppose to a certain extent, destroyer of all things, Lord over all things. Nothing is created that he did not create. A one single designer does it all. Fortunately, I'm in him, he in me as one, John 17, so there's no separation. I came from above, as Jesus said, he came from above. We mentioned that the other day, and then I knew that. And above, of course, is anything from the celestials to the ethereal to, well, whatever your imagination can come up with. I mean, you're not wrong, because imaginings, you can't imagine anything that would be wrong, because everything you could imagine comes from the Creator anyway, right? Because he gave you the imagination. Couple things I wanted to read, and so I'm going to try to do this once again, because we lost the podcast from yesterday because it wouldn't upload, and I did a test this morning and it did work. So I'm not completely prepared, so what I'm going to try to do is get into my my set mail here, if I see if I can find the one that I was going to read. Okay, a couple things. One, this was part of it, an email that came the other day from a brother in the Lord, and he says, for your consideration in part one, I believe the Lord has showed me the answer to the question about church-taught free will, and also the talk you gave on 11.7.13, wondering about the separation of physical and spiritual DNA. I believe that in all the things that the Word says happened before the foundation of the world was a decision on an individual basis to accept or reject the truth, and the ones that rejected the truth were, as the Word says, we're given a spirit of delusion. At one time I shared that when the truth is presented, 66% will reject it. Dividing the sons of God from the sons of the devil. On a cellular level, and on an interesting level, it explains the total division of sons. Of 33% of the angels fell, if 33% of the angels fell, and 66% of the humans fell, then 66% of the angels did not fall, and 33% of the humans did not fall before the foundation of the earth. Pretty interesting, huh? Then you have 100% of the children of obedience and disobedience for your consideration. And so he, you know, basically has had that revelation laid on him, and I'm fascinated with it. It just seems so symmetrical. You know, I love it when it's really mathematical, you know, and not just like some random thing, but some precise thing like, yeah, you know, humans, 66% fell, angels, 33%, equaling 100%, you know, or if you like, 33 and a third or whatever, 66 and two thirds equal, 66 and two thirds and 33 and one third would equal 100%. Okay, I know that. I still remember my math. I don't need to look that up. It was just embedded in me. But look at the symmetry here of what this guy is saying. 33% of the angels fell, meaning 66 and two-thirds percent, you know, let's be precise. 33 and a third of the angels, how could I put it better? 33.3, I guess. And then 66.6 or 666, which I know excites you to no end. So, okay. At any rate, 33 and a third, 33% fell. 66% did not fall of the angels. 66% of the humans do fall. It's symmetrical. It's like a law. And 33% do not fall. Let's put it in future tense and make it really interesting. 66% of humans at any given time will fail to comprehend the word of God. The 66% at any given time in any generation upon the earth fail to comprehend the word of God. And, you know, fail to comprehend God, fail to comprehend the Spirit, right? Fail to the biggest ironic one would be the church. It failed at Jesus. So 66% fail. That would be our society. But there's 33% that hear the word and heed because they belong there, because that's, you know, they recognize the language of the one who calls us speaks in a language that only we can understand. The world can't understand it. Similarly, we don't understand the language of the world, of the street smart world and the workers of iniquity, which tend to run the churches and religions, not realizing that the whole point is not to be carnal, and they don't get it. They make it carnal and therefore tethered to the earth because they're earth dwellers. But, you know, we have this war going on in the heavens and upon the earth between the 66%, which is the majority upon the earth, versus the 33% who are then therefore bullied, right, persecuted, versus 33% of the angels that rebelled, which would be a minority, versus the majority, the 66%. So the mirror opposite, above as below, which is perfect, which actually makes tremendous sense because makes perfect sense. So at any given time, you're dealing with 33% of the angels that and of the realm of say evil would be 33% in terms of the multidimensional reality of the occult. It's only 33%. It's not the majority. It's 33% of these angels run the world. They have the possession of the earth, and they've enslaved the 33% of the humans. There are 33% of the angels that are wicked, and there are 66% of the humans that belong to the fallen angels, and there's 33% that belong to the Lord that are being bullied by the angelic realm, the fallen angel realm, and the 66% who feel they are the world. They feel that they have the system. They win the game. They have a game. They have a whole matrix to enter into. And the 33% are never going to be there because they don't belong. Not only that, their DNA doesn't allow them to enter in or break on through to that side. By the way, break on through the other side is a reference to death. I'm not sure people really understand that. When you break on through to the other side, as Jim Morrison suggested, you're dead. You're dead. You're the realm of the dead. You're Hades. And that's fine. A lot of people, excuse me, help me out there, Trish. I mean, a lot of people think it's funny. Tisk, tisk. Yes, yes. We're the dead, the grateful dead. Tisk, tisk. Oh, isn't it fun? But then they're the first ones to complain of police brutality. It's like, excuse me, police brutality is the realm of the dead, idiot. And so where you went is police brutality, and now you complain about it, jerk. You know, if you don't want to pay for it, don't do it. It's your choice. Serve the Lord or serve the devil, which is the carnal. Fine. Some of the, in the carnal realm, you know, like I say, we have religions, institutions, diseducation, sports, movies, and all that is the realm of the carnal, you know, Washington, D.C., politicians, all of that, all the circus what we see on a daily basis is the realm of the carnal, okay? It's the realm of Satan. I'm not saying that, you know, they are, everybody worships Satan. I'm just saying the realm of the carnal, the realm of the world system, Babylon, is run by Satan. And when I say Satan, we mean 33% of the angels that rebelled, which is also an allegory of something else. I think there was a division that was, in other words, God made them to be who they are, right? Because he's orchestrating this whole reality. But I love that, brother, that 33%, 66% in heaven versus a mirror opposite, 66% fallen on the earth, 33%, you know, belong to the Lord, and he doesn't lose any of his. We get called out of Babylon all the time, but I can tell you, and I know that my friends will agree with me, I never really fit into Babylon. I don't know about you, but I saw guys that really excelled at it when we were in high school, and they just had it wired, you know. It was just amazing. They could deal drugs and make a profit, and they became like, you know, entrepreneurs and businessmen. Eventually they joined the CIA and ran drugs for the guns for the Sandinistas and drugs and, you know, killed people. And, you know, now they're running drones and, you know, there's a whole system for them, right? And their leader is dear Obama, who was a foreign exchange student that got into the very shishi elitist Punahou school in Hawaii, which you can't get into, I can tell you, without, you know, great connections, without being part of high society, you ain't getting in. That's a very exclusive school, one of the most in the world, not just the United States. And so the whole background on him, and Obama told his peers, you know, that he was a foreign student, and he was at that time an out-of-the-closet homosexual. So that was all established. So these people were horrified when they saw him become president, because they said, you know, the guy was like a con man, dealing drugs. He would lie to everybody about everything, about, you know, he was just what did this woman say that knew him? She said, you don't trust this guy with your dog. You know what I mean? And it's like, yeah. And he continued, and she said he lied. Continue. This is one of his peers that knew him from Waikiki and from just being around the island of Oahu at the time. And he just lied and lied and lied and lied and continued to lie. And it's like, yeah, and that's what he does today. Every time he speaks, he lies. The entire time is all lies. Only idiots, I mean absolute abject fools, support this guy. People that are just dishonest within themselves and have absolutely no moral fiber whatsoever. You know, no backbone, no yearning for freedom, no morals. You know, who look at him as a savior or a Superman who can get into a fight with people they hate, which are, I guess, conservatives or whatever. And so he's going to be the battering ram, you know, the liar. You know, you see, they've made a deal with the devil is what they've done. And so what's happening, and I'm here to predict it, the entire thing collapses. I told you that. You know what? Give me a little props here. How about when everybody else was on the, you know, conspiracy networks, which I guess is where I end up being. I don't mean to be, because I'm not really into all that. Like, I don't feed you like you really, you know, like if you're a real junkie, you got to go to like, I don't know. I would even leave the Christian thing. I go more to the UFO thing because you get fed more, you know. But, you know, remember the old Art Bell show, right? And feed me that conspiracy. But as far as Obama is concerned, I mean, you know, the unlucky Barry thing, you know, people just didn't believe me. You know, and then further, you know, I don't hate the guy. I mean, I think he's got a problem, but I mean, he's salvageable too, you know, so we got to pray for them. And I found myself this morning once again praying for, you know, Congress, praying for the president, praying for everybody to come to their better angels, let's just put it that way, unfallen angels, you know, and I don't count anybody out, even though I just have to say that we have to call it when we see it. You know, if you see someone lying continuously and the country's in jeopardy and people are in jeopardy, And there's a real sense that a World War III nuclear scenario could go down because of the incompetence of the president. It needs to be pointed out, even though we pray for him, you know. You see what I mean? And it's not, we're not making a judgment. It's just like, if you have someone that's not qualified to be there, someone who's completely incompetent, or, you know, someone who is dangerous because of the pathological lying, and who has alienated allies and you know, has made the world a very dangerous place, who's cored out the military, thus changing the balance of power in the world, you call them on it. You don't let someone with no experience, who's been mainly a con artist through life, who never really published anything with the Harvard Law School Review, who's been coddled the entire time, trained for this communist commie takeover, had good pedigree, though, in the communist world, being Frank Marshall Davis being his father, and Ann Dunham being his mother, and his grandparents also being dyed-in-the-wool communist, along with Ann, his mother, and then, you know, his white mother, and then his black father, Frank Marshall Davis, who was a communist pornographer. So he's had that kind of, I mean, if a guy like that can come all the way to the good, that's amazing. Because when you start off being traumatized and turned out when you're, you know, a little kid, that's got to be really, really tough, you know. I don't think anyone really knows who the guy is. I don't, you know, I don't think even his, the thing that makes me sad is when, you know, in order to make this narrative that Barry is not gay, and that, you know, we are pending on Michelle and the kids, you know, from 2004, let's say, which isn't that long ago. You know, we're talking maybe 9 or 10 years. And to make the narrative fit, people would be murdered, you know, like ex-lovers and at the Reverend Wright Church, getting murdered to cover up his Tris, or if anyone else comes forward, there's a danger that they might get murdered too. I hate to see that. You know, that we saw that in the days of Bill Clinton, and anyone that saw him doing anything would be like friends of Bill List. You know, it was almost a joke that they'd be offed. And you know, there's truth to that. You know, there are assassins that are paid to go do that, and we understand who they are and what they do and the way it works. I hate to see that in politics. I don't know about Bush, because he didn't know, it wasn't, if there was something there, it wasn't famous. Like there was some thing with Skull and Bones that, you know, that all the men, you know, have their gay lovers and then they have their families. I can verify that in really high society, they're all, you know, cross-dressers and you know, flaming gays and all that, Bohemian Grove. That's a known thing, that you're bisexual at least, and then you have your family, but then you have the men. Why they want to keep that hidden, and then they're supporting gay rights, maybe they want to come out of the closet one day. But that's a ritualistic requirement for high society living. You've got to be, you know, sexually libertine, meaning omnisexual, really, is what it is. And also have a penchant for the occult. It's terrible. It's a terrible slavery. And, you know, everyone I've talked to said that I had to do that to get in the club, or I wouldn't have gotten in. You know? And if you want to get in, you bow down to that reality. So we can't hold one guy responsible. Say, well, this one guy, Barry Satoro. It's, you know, the whole thing. The name changed to Barry Satoro, I suppose, was further trying to legitimize the idea that, you know, there's a stable, you know, mother and father image. Remember, communists seek to break the family up. So the idea that he would be sired by, you know, that his father would be Frank Marshall Davis and not Barack Obama, you know, that there was that kind of looseness with people, you know, kids were coming from all over the place. Because in communism, there isn't the strong family. So you're liable to get pregnant or have kids from all over the place, from numerous. It's a libertine atmosphere. It's anything goes. It's basically the political externalization of Satanism, is what communism is. And so this is well known. Bathhouse Barry is well known, along with his buddy Rahm Emanuel in Chicago. It's been well published, not just conspiracies, but it's just known. I mean, it's out there. You know, about Barry's being mainly, according to the gay community in Chicago, Barry Satoru, a.k.a. Barack Hussein Obama Jr., is gay and not bi or not nothing in between. It's always been the same thing. We also have testimony from people that knew him in Oahu. Same thing. He was gay. He's never been interested in women. And so this family thing is a sham. The point where I come into it is I'm not judging people for being, you know, whatever they are. But when they lie, when they're being vetted, and they lie being vetted, being a foreign exchange student, not a natural born citizen, and being, in other words, he was born elsewhere than Hawaii, you know? And the Hawaiians know that. They've covered it up. They were told to cover it up. So there's been all this muscle put in, all this mafia tactics, to keep this narrative, to convince who? Me? I already know the truth. So who are they trying to convince by killing all these people? And the reason they keep doing it on a massive scale, even though more and more people understand what's happened, is because they have a grander plan to bring about this grand communist globalist scheme and this world order that they seek to and part of that is fueled and funded by the labor of the people of the United States to confiscate it and to confiscate property and lavish themselves in Elysium. And that's why communism never worked. It's just Fritz Lang's 1927 movie, Metropolis. If you want to see it, I mean, there was a great, and that's how it even got the robots and the machines in there. That was one of the most advanced movies of all time. You must see it in any way, shape, or form. I'm going to compose some music to it. I love taking the silent images and composing. So I've done it once. I'm going to do it again and have a video of the Metropolis. I did score the Queen of Babylon scene. And the Queen of Babylon's in there, and the men are all mesmerized. And basically, they're trying to institutionalize this mesmerization, this hypnotic. Now, let me go into the 66% for a sec. Okay, so this 66%, and I'm going to have to stop this soon because I don't know if it'll go up. The 66% that are deluded, that my friends here said they're deluded, it's more than that. They're actually hypnotized, okay? And so one could say, well, if you could break the spell, then could they be of the Lord? And it's like, well, all things are of the Lord, you know, technically. There's a greater philosophical argument that all things collapse into one point in the end and then expands again, light, dark, good, evil, blah, 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 and so that it's just a process, impersonal. If you want to make that, some of you scientific types like that, that's fine. With me, it doesn't bother me at all. It does not contradict the Word of God or the Bible at all. And the Bible is only the Word of God to those who have the Holy Spirit. Otherwise, it's just a big dumb book, as Steve Martin used to say about it. It's just a big dumb book. It absolutely, Steve Martin's correct. It is a big, dumb, boring book. Unless it's speaking to you. And it can't speak to you unless you belong to it. And if you belong to it, then you get the Word of God there, you get the Word of God through people, events, whatever. I get it through the news. So Unlucky Barry, you know, and then it's really gotten unlucky lately. I mean, it's really gotten bad now. And then the danger of where it is now is when you get a guy backed up into a corner like this, and that means all the people that backed him and the military that's been cored out to the, you know, pretty much decimated while DHS has been built up. You know, when it gets, these kind of people have, you know, they don't like Americans. The Pentagon does not like Americans. Washington hates Americans at this way. Not everybody, but in general terms, the educational system hates Americans. It seems that everybody in the world hates America and hates Americans. And the whole point of all this coup d'etat, which is what it is, over several presidents, has been to destroy America from within, and that's been the whole point. And to do that, you've got to destroy God. So what are we talking about? We're talking about the age-old, stupid, I'm so sick of this, war against God by the 66%. Gosh dang it. Does it have to be, can't we have some intelligence? A little bit. And now we see George Bush out there trying to recruit Jews to bring about Bible prophecy. That makes him an idiot as well. Can't we stop this? Is there any way to stop the insane, the litany of human stupidity ever? You humans could be free and profitable. Work a couple of days a week. Enjoy your kids. Enjoy travel. Enjoy cultivating talents that you may have, because the Lord wants you to do that. But instead, you give your power away so that you struggle under slavery to be free when you already had the keys to be free. Why do you do that? Why do you want them to confiscate all your money and resources so you have to work like a dog and have no time for anything but to die? Why? Why do you do that to yourselves? I have to separate myself and address you like that, because I just can't say, why do we do it? Why do you do it to the 66% that feels that, and most of them, by the way, feel they have God. So, you know, it's mind-boggling. But why would you want human suffering? Why not when, have you ever been in an airplane? And when you fly, you see all the bounty and opportunity out there? It's beautiful. It's lovely. Why not share it? Why do a small, like 2%, or not even that, like 1%, not even that, point whatever, you know, 9% or whatever, control the 99.9%? Why do the 0.1% control the 99.9%? It's not even the 1%, it's the 0.9%. Have enslaved you all and made it so that you toil for your bread and you toil for this and you toil for that. Then they confiscate it in the way of taxes. Why do you let them tax you like that so that you can't ever get ahead? And why should they make a career out of being politicians? And then the special interests run them. And they're anti-you. Now we have police going around sticking their hands in the crotches of people and up their bums and everything else. And it's like, you know, this is becoming, it's outrageous. With all the lawsuits, they keep on doing it anyway, even more so. They don't care about lawsuits. That's some kind of a conditioning, domestication program. Why would you allow yourselves to be like cattle? Well, you've got no, what is the point of you then? If you're just going to sit there and take it. You know, you've never known good, friend. It's been bad your whole life. And that goes for all of you. It goes for all of us. You're having to put in the time of working getting further behind. And now they put this albatross around your neck, Obamacare, that nobody can afford for the purpose of further enslaving you and running further debt up and taxing more to the point where the people's back is broken. Why are you letting the military and Obama do this to you? Since you're going to be dead anyway, why not fight back? And that's the point of my next statement, that, well, there are people going to fight back. And, you know, I told you in 2008 that if things don't get straightened out, this will just go to blood. You know, if, you know, what they're figuring on is peaceful people will be domesticated and docile. And they're trained at the airports, now trained at bus stations, trained at train stations, that you're subservient, and that's why they put their hand up your ass. Because that teaches you you're a slave. That's why they use that technique. You know, your children belong to them. If they want sex with your children, they'll do it right in front of you. What are you going to say about it? I mean, they'll go all the way to that. And that's, by the way, what I'm describing has been the age-old evil from the beginning of time. And you know why it's being enabled in here, the United States? Because 66% of these people belong to that mafia organization. 66%. That's why you don't win elections, 33%. And that goes as to why. So what are we supposed to do? Well, the Lord gave us some clues. One, give to Caesar what's Caesar's regarding taxes. And in other words, you can't hold on to anything. You know,
build your wealth in heaven. Do the best you can here, and some of you are very wealthy, some of you are very poor, but do the best you can, but keep your eyes on heavenward, because that's where you came from, before this earth began, before there were moons and stars and everything. You were with your Father in heaven. You came from above. They come from below. Do you understand that? Never the twain shall meet, and never will you get along with them. You know, you're the 33%, they're the 66%, and much of the 33% are sleeping right now. Maybe there's, you know, 9%. And when you add up in the book of Revelation how much of the earth gets hurt and how many people die, some of that 33% goes along with the 66%. And, you know, the rain falls on the good and the just and unjust alike. And that's just unfortunate. But again, you have to suspend your judgment about what this world is and about whether Yahweh was good or bad in creating it and this whole narrative. And we have to let go of that, as I said in the last podcast. You've got to suspend that judgment, and you have to know that the Lord is good. And what child asking his father for bread, what father would give his son a stone? No, your Father will reward you. But go back to the Lord's Prayer, and I keep doing this because everyone can have the Lord's Prayer. If you don't have a Bible, don't have Bible knowledge, that's fine. You can go by the Lord's Prayer. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Heaven. Before Abraham was, I am. Before Abraham was, I am. Me. Before Abraham was, you are. You. And that's the mystery of John 17, which no church, which are all carnal, will ever unravel for anybody. Because if you knew the truth, you would not need, all you would need is God. And you wouldn't need intercessors and inner this and inner that and popes and pastors and you know, ministers and, you know, this sort of elaborate elite priesthood that's going to tell you what to do all day long. You wouldn't need Billy Graham to unfold his big prophecy, which now all the Illuminati people, or whatever you want to call them, the hooked up, connected secret society people, are all going willy-nilly trying to do carnal things to bring about a carnal return of Christ. It's like, it doesn't work that way. You're not going to manipulate God. You're not going to just manipulate world events unless you want to come up with a fake Jesus. But the Lord doesn't return as a carnal thing. It's not that at all. I'm already, you know, for example, when you enter in within to the kingdom of heaven, it's done. Thank you, Jesus. He's the door by which we may enter in to the Father, then the Father and the Son and me. We are one. There's nothing more to it. It's consummated. The wedding feast has occurred. I'm in the New Jerusalem. What do you want from me? I can't help that. Oh, you want me to have a little process where we follow a bouncing ball? That's what I mean by the world versus the truth. The world needs you to follow a bouncing ball and to be hypnotized so that you don't get out of this prison sentence, which is what it is in a way, but in a way it's a test, in a way it's also a learning center. But it is not what it purports to be, like some serious thing. It's not that serious. I mean, it's serious if you don't get it and don't get out of here. Then you're recycled and your life is not your own. And then they're just going to, all they're going to do with you, the lizards, they're going to recycle you again and again. And they're going to just rip you off and make you miserable and make you die and hurt your children and hurt you and hurt what's dignified. And try to turn everything into some kind of a satanic brothel of evil that preys upon children and human sacrifice. Child sacrifice, I should say. That's their main thing they like. And these people join that club, and then they go around on CNN and on TV, you know, these politicians that are think they've joined some coven for the first time, like the you know, and the witches and stuff, and they're just bouncing around, lording it over you, and then you give them all your power, and then they torture you. And then you complain to the Lord, And you go down miserable. In the end, one big miserable, swirling, spiraling, awful conundrum of pain, suffering, and tears. And no good and no light and no nothing. Just all pain, all jackboot on your neck forever, as George Orwell put it. And then, or you fall susceptible to a cult. You know, there's New Age cults, there's Christian cults, there's Jewish cults, there's cults all over the place that will give you the comfort you're seeking for this sort of temporary ethereal experience by worshiping the leader. And people get so into the cults that they'll even murder for their leader. You're dealing with, you know, a very unconscious planet, a very hypnotized, controlled, you know, planet of zombies who will do what they're programmed to do. Say what they're programmed to say. I've seen it. I've seen when they went through the other side, they had their change in high school, they started talking a different language. I'm like, oh. And it's like, okay, are they held captive, Lord, or are they prodigals? What's the answer? And the answer is, you know, prodigals are very, very few. There are people who are asleep, I suppose you'd call them prodigals, but prodigals are very, very few. That is, people working on Satan's side, in evil, workers of iniquity, who later will wake up and go, oh, I was wrong. Most people that are working in that, in those pigsties, and those are pigs in a pigsty, that's exactly what they are have full knowledge of their free will, and they have full intent in what they're doing, and they aim to make money and get ahead, which is why they're doing it, and these the Lord has rejected. They are part of that 66%. They are operating under strong delusion, which the Lord will give you if you go over there. He'll give you strong delusion so that you think you're actually doing good when you're not doing good. And it leads us to the crisis of where we are today, where we have these people in power, in office, who aren't fit to run, you name it, a lemonade stand. They're not fit to do that. They wouldn't know how to do that, even if you handed it to them. That's how incompetent the politicians are. And beginning with the commander-in-chief, who has absolutely no authority in his experience to run a military at all. So who's running it is Valerie Jarrett. She's the one who's firing all the military people. I just, look, you know, do I want to know this stuff? I already know. Before these people do anything, I already know what they're going to do. You know, and they keep running these false flags until now. It's sort of like if you give yourself too much antibiotic, eventually, you know, your body rejects it. If you do too many false flags, what happens? Eventually, everybody calls you on it. It's all over the internet, and it's everywhere, right? So now it's, you know, thanks to this president, the term false flag has gone completely viral to where people are always wondering. I mean, back in the Clinton day, you know, a helicopter goes down, something happens, and then we would all say, gee, I wonder who was on that helicopter and what he knew. Because, you know, they'll take the whole helicopter out just to get one guy, or the whole plane just to get one guy. Gee, who was on that plane? Just to save their political hide. And I think it's disgusting. You know, it makes America a tawdry piece of crap place. You know, just a really dirty place. And it's the people's fault. It's not the politician's fault. It's the people. The 66% that want to throw God off the cliff, that think they're so damn smart, who think they know what's best for everybody. And then the whole immigrant thing is just getting the dumbest people on earth to immigrate. They're dumb not because they're not dumb natively, but they're dumb because they have no education, they have no ability to think. They're coming out of these totalitarian regimes like Mexico, and they just vote for whoever's going to give me stuff. That makes them dumb, you know, dumbed down like sheep, you know, little cattle. And they want these people because they know they can count on their vote. It's that 66% again, you know, who worship the devil, who belong to the devil. That's why it was so funny that Nancy Pelosi wanted to go have communion, you know, proving the Catholic Church is what. She wanted to go have communion, and the guy was like, maybe I shouldn't give it to you because you're such an abortionist. You know, she's such a blatant Satanist, and just out of the closet, you know, total 100% down with the devil, and dumb as all get out. And wants to have communion with her other mafia brothers and sisters. And it's like, I look at that, I just go, my God, Lord, how can anyone take, if you know what's going on and you see, if you've got the smarts to be able to see what everything means, you know, rather than what it's on the, presents itself on the surface. And if you are in that 33%, it makes it very difficult, you know, to go forward, especially when the religionistas start going holier than thou on you, knowing that they belong to the devil, and then they're presenting their, like the Billy Graham thing. To me, I'm sorry, I like the conservative values, I like the Franklin Graham charity outreach, I like the, you know, but it's the guy's fault. It's all false. It's rotting dead fruit. And now Billy Graham and all his wisdom at 95 years old is going to roll out this like return of Christ scenario while George Bush is funding people that are converting Jews to Christianity. Like he's going to have something to do with this effect of the return of, I'm beyond, I'm just happy that I'm not in that whole mess. I can't imagine how awful it would be to be George Bush. That must be a terrible, terrible burden to think, to have this be your spiritual legacy, that you're paying groups to convert Jews so that you can effect the return of Jesus, which I read yesterday to my horror. I'm like, hasn't this guy learned anything? Nothing? Like, what you see is what you get? So I look at that, and then I look at the rest of them, and they're not much better, you know? They have no idea what the Spirit is, no idea what God is, no idea why they're here. They just are grabbing for the short result over and over and over again. And, you know, it's like a perception thing. It's like a consciousness thing. I think this divide, ladies and gentlemen, at the end of the day, is done by the Lord ahead of time, before we ever came to this planet, in a certain mathematical context between heaven and earth, because we came from heaven to be here, and some people, I guess, came from the earth. But there are not three possibilities, there's two. And somehow the symmetry of that, of those numbers our brother gave us, you know, there, tend to show some sort of design in this whole thing. Not a random thing like the church says, oh, you never know, they could repent, they might not. No, there's a certain number. I believe in that. I believe that no matter, it's and that's the equilibrium of it, no matter what generation we're talking about on earth, it's the same distribution. I absolutely see that very clearly. It's also a leap of faith on my part, but I mean, it just fits. Like, if the shoe fits, you put it on. I don't think I'm going to let go of that one. You know, it may not be the whole answer, but it's enough of something to hang on to, which I do believe in predetermined outcomes, because the Lord is the author of the Word of God, which was written in the end from the beginning. So all of this, even this talk right here, is scripted. There's nothing I have of any merit of mine. All I have that's any good is what the Lord gives me. The rest of it is through a glass darkly and murky, you know. You're the ones that have to decide, you know, to separate the wheat from the chaff and to take the good and leave the bad and leave my own, you know, human foible behind. But even human foible is factored into the entire equation. You know, we're meant to be lower than the angels. We're meant to be imperfect vessels. We're meant to all have this commonality of a fallen condition, but two different places to belong to. One, heaven, or two. And they go, well, when I die, I'm going to go to heaven. I go, oh, you're not there? You mean something's going to happen after you die? Like, then something will change? Why haven't you entered in? The kingdom of God is heaven, which is within you. And you talk to people like that, and their eyes glaze over. They can't understand it. They want, and I'm like, well, you know, of course you can't understand it. You've been diseducated your whole life. You've been brainwashed your whole life. And you've been taught this carnal way and this very tough, you know, thing, and then somehow you overlook, the church overlooks the abortion issue, which is not abortion, it's child sacrifice, which is done. That's why Obama sent out an email recently that said, if you're against late-term abortion, you're sexist. This is beyond Adolf Hitler. This is beyond anybody in terms of
that I've ever heard do anything. That was the stupidest thing Obama's done, simply sealing his fate as a ne'er-do-well, you know, lost boy, you know? Late-term abortion is child sacrifice. They want it to be late-term because then it's like a child being sacrificed on the altar, so they don't have to do it literally, you know, with one that's outside the womb or whatever. This is an age-old pagan sacrament done by all the civilizations that have fallen upon the earth, all the people of the obelisk and the pyramid, wherever you find them, whether it's the Maya, whether it's the Egyptians, whether it's the Greeks, whether it's the Romans, whether it's the Chinese, whether it's the Vedic peoples of the past. Child sacrifice has been throughout the world. I've studied it. And even in the Old Testament, you know, it's basically, you know, the idea to appease these gods, to have a better time on earth. It never ends, by the way. You're having to, once you're going down that path of the dark side, you know, the criminal side, not only do you prey upon the people, but you prey upon each other, and you have to keep doing movements and events and things to keep your mojo working, or you lose it. So there's all these people doing all competing to do all these bad things in a race to the bottom, selling you people out, you people that put your politicians there, they're selling you out right and left, putting you in slavery, and then you keep doing it, and everyone keeps participating in it, though it's going to complete catastrophe. And then the answer that they have at the end of the day is to arm up as much as they can because they intend to start shooting people instead of feeding them. I find that, and then we fund that so that we can have a hand in our own suicide. I am amazed, and then that becomes one big satanic ritual where the elites at the very top fly off to Elysium. So sorry, humanity, that we destroyed you all, but we, us great people, we get to hang out in Elysium and have a great old time. Let me explain what's going to happen to you. Number one, that scenario will never go through. Look for surprises. Trish, can you stop that one out there? Look for surprises and look for reversals. And just as I said, in terms of, you know, a lot of people are feeling like something terrible is going to happen. You need to be ready for anything on any level. Cosmological, on the war front with nukes, Israel nukes are at Gog Magog war, for those of you into Bible prophecy. They want to bring that about in order to affect, you know, what they're all trying to affect Bible prophecy. They all want this to be the wrap up and to have, you know, what they don't realize is that the Bible would be true that if they were able to get what they wanted, there would be the fall of Babylon and terrible judgment from God that would end up killing them all. So I don't know why they, because they believe, many of them, that they're doing God's will. And I just, there are many here among us who feel that life is but a joke all along the watchtower, you know, the Bob Dylan song. It's like, it really kind of turns out to be true. The ones who see it as a kind of joke. I mean, what I've described here is a kind of a joke, isn't it? The joke is that they think somehow that we aren't going to see, or that God won't see. I mean, if I see pretty much as I can handle, I don't want to see anymore. But I mean, the rest of it, you know, there's a dark side. I'm just describing the surface stuff. I mean, but I'm not that interested in their carnal world and their way of life, because it's really the way of, it only leads to death, so it's not of interest to me. My interest is getting out of here. You know, I can't really explain what my interest is, but it's not getting out of here like escaping. It's putting it all together. It's like a restoration. It's hard for me to put into words. But I'm on the way to it, and I experience it every day. You know, it's the thing that keeps me going when I'm in sorrow. It's the thing that keeps me grounded from flipping out and putting it on all on my shoulders, which I've seen some talk show hosts do lately. They put it all on their shoulders. It's like, this has already been written, man. You just do the best you can. You know, trust in the Lord, and don't. I was just thinking the other day, you know, boy, maybe I shouldn't travel anymore because, you know, then I might not be able to get back home because of, you know, these terrible events that are all looming. World War III, massive terror attacks like shooting down airliners or whatever. Now we have the anti-aircraft shoulder weapons given to Al-Qaeda. And then there's the threat of, yeah, they're going to start shooting down airplanes unless we invade Syria or whatever. But yet we're funding them. We're the ones who gave them the weapons so they could shoot us down in airliners, right? I mean, none of this makes sense from any level. You can't... How about the example that these people that talk in riddles like this, you know, trying to justify themselves, what kind of example do they set for our children? Don't you think your kid in college might start asking questions? Well, I did, and of course those questions led to my, you know, understanding or my became my path in life. Those questions that I asked at an early age, when I saw the reaction of my parents and my teachers, I realized I was on to the right track. And then they threatened me and did bad things to me, all because I asked a couple of questions. When I asked the priest, as you'll recall, here it is again, when I asked him, look how much abundance there is in the sea, when I was overlooking, standing on the porch of this house my family had for a couple of generations in La Jolla, California. Well, now, no longer. No longer for a lot of years now. But when I was a kid, you know, and when I was younger, I had access to that. And I was standing on the porch, and some friends visited, one being a priest and one being a friend of my wife's. And I knew this guy, you know. And I asked him about the abundance in the sea, and he got all pissed off. He goes, oh, come on, a man has to make a living. Translation, oh, come on, a man has to bow down to make a living. He's got to get permission from those above him and become their slave in order to have a career path. I said, well, look how much... I don't understand it. You know, there's enough for everybody, for everyone to be a millionaire, all the people on the planet. You know, and well-fed, and have families, and have lives, and have peace. But 0.9%, I'm sorry, 0.1%, not 1%, but 0.1%, dominate the rest of the humans? Oh, that's just sick. Well, they have a little help from the 33% of fallen angels. That makes it a little bit different. And they only need a select few to run the thing because people are cowards and they're going to bow down and they're going to be hypnotized. They're going to be recycled and their souls they don't consider to be valuable. So they're going to sell their souls. They're going to get scalped. And they're going to scalp their kids and rape their kids and abort their babies. And they're going to create an environment where the leaders that you see are a reflection of the inner life of the majority of the people in any given nation. And then the nation will collapse. Been the pattern from the very beginning. Now, could we say, do you love humanity if you've written off 66%? I'm just saying the number is 3366 at any given time. That's what's resonated with me. That's my kind of rima off the rima, if you will. 33% at any given time, 66% at any given time in a state of equilibrium. Does that mean people switch sides? Yeah, people can switch sides. One way and the other, they switch from the light to the dark, from the dark to the light, whatever. But there's this general 66-33, and it's the reverse in the heavenlies. It's 33, you know, bad, 66 good, and here it's, you know, 66 bad, 33 good. Good meaning light, 33 light, 66 dark, and, you know, 33 dark, 66 light in a mirror image. Heaven to earth, earth to heaven, which is really, you know, it's not just up, it's like through a dimension lens that it's a real breaking through to the other side. It's really a mystery too, but it has a symmetrical reflection of the earth. That's why the occultists will have, like, the greatest satanic symbol in America is the Washington Monument over the reflecting pool, which then mirrors heaven and earth, or weds heaven and earth. With the obelisk, which is a symbol for Satan. Very simple. It's in all the history books. It's It's already been well documented upon the earth that that's what's going on in Washington, D.C. I don't know what else to tell you. I wouldn't have a world like this. And I don't like it when I see these elites in Hollywood, and I've been around them personally, where they laugh about the little people, you know, and they intend to do against the people's will because they consider them garbage. And yet when they're on camera and stuff, they're, oh, my heart bleeds for the hurting people that don't have health insurance. Oh. But in privately, they use the N-word about blacks and all this. And these are the uber liberals of Hollywood saying the N-word and saying all this stuff and you know, dumb Mexicans and blah, 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 you know. More like this, you know. Oh, those immigrants, they're so, publicly, but then privately they're calling them, you know, all these pejorative names. And I've seen that my whole life. And I always wondered, well, why do the people believe them when they're for the, I just can't imagine. And no, I don't believe Mexican people are dumb, you know, not me. I believe they're dumbed down, some of them, the bulk that want to vote for the people who are giving them stuff. This whole amnesty thing, trying to get in a voting block to make sure the Republicans never win again or whatever it is, that kind of thing. And the people that would go along with that, I think, are dumbed down and programmed. But all the Mexicans, we're close to the border here and all that. I know lots of Mexicans, and they're all very good people. And, you know, just people like, you know, anywhere else, people like you run into in America and Europe, whatever, they're just people, you know, and they want their children to do well, and they might make stupid political decisions in order to, I'm clarifying my earlier thing, they might make stupid decisions to, because they think it'll help their children, so it's understandable, but it's just, you see what's going on, and it's hard for me to, I just have to start like that, you know, the idea that Obama would be out there just lying his teeth off and contradicting himself in real time like hundreds of times and then have the news media not call him on it. I don't even know what world I'm living in anymore. It's just like the Twilight Zone. Do you even, you, how could he get a pass from any decent person? So I quit looking at the news media because, and then every once in a while you get a guy that wakes up like this Dylan Radigan guy who's like an uber left kind of guy, and I've seen him a few times on, I guess it was MSNBC, and then he just went off one day and did a perfect rant on the problem that we have. But he was still making the mistake of blaming Republicans for the shutdown or the Tea Party or whatever. The shutdown was Valerie Jarrett's idea in the first place. It was her. She's the architect. It was her idea. And the idea was to force the shutdown, figuring Republicans would pull the trigger, but to force them into that situation by saying that you won't negotiate, then blame everything on them. But the initial idea of the shutdown came from Valerie Jarrett, and that's being, you'll hear that more and more and more as we go forward. She was the one that wanted to, and it's kind of backfired at this point, but Obama's still out there saying, you know, that shutdown really hurt us, but I hope we never do that again. And he's just out there again lying like the worst used car salesman you've ever seen in your life. Embarrassing. I feel like, you know, gently walking him off the stage and saying, brother, just don't do this to yourself anymore. Can you imagine the videotape when people start putting tape together on you? Can you imagine?
Darling.
Yes.
Egypt has filed criminal charges against Barack Hussein Obama.
Yeah.
Arming the...
right.
Yeah, and being helping the Muslim Brotherhood.
Right. You know, he's a complete traitor and communist and everything else. But we've known that, and we've told you that from 2008, from the time of his election on, we've told you what he is. But you have to realize pretty much the entire Democrat Party are communists, and they are revolutionaries, and they're radicals. Obama is an extremist of the most extreme sort who tries to pass himself off as a moderate and then calls people with moderate values, for example, libertarians are moderate because they're not socially conservative. They're mainly fiscally conservative. He calls them extremist, and they should be put on terrorist lists. This, only an extremist would do what he did regarding libertarians. And if you don't believe me, I would urge you to go read Reason Magazine. Reason Magazine is very reasonable, but that's a libertarian magazine published in Los Angeles with some very smart writers, and they make a lot of sense. But it, there's none of this sort of evangelical end times programming, you know, that's going, that there's no religion there at all, which is why I like it. I believe that faith and spirituality really need to be, you know, if you want to practice your faith, like I like praying with people, and I like sharing the word of God with people, and sharing, you know, Rima with people, and I do that as in my priestly function here, as you're a priest as well. But no one believes I'm a priest, because I have no church, because my church is not of this world. Don't you understand that? And neither is yours. My home is not of this world. My true home, my eternal home, where there is no death, where I live, is not of this world. And I did not come from this world. I came from up there. And so did many of you. Nothing special here. You know, but it is special, I guess, if you're... It is and it isn't. The scorpions and serpents and the people thereof came from below. I came from above. Jesus said, that's what he said when he addressed the scribes and the Pharisees. Let's close by going into that. Let's go there and let's see. Let me read something that I told the sister I was going to read it, and she did not object, so I'm going to read it. This iPad's getting really hot. That's weird. Here it is. The foundation of the Protestant evangelical charismatic Christianity being based on a born-again experience is bogus and a lie. Jesus is saying in John 3:3 and 3:7, not to marvel that in order to see the kingdom of heaven, you have to originally come from above, a Greek word anathen, or heaven, just as Jesus came from heaven above. Once again, Jesus is saying in John 3:3 and 3:7, not to marvel that in order to see the kingdom of heaven, you have to originally come from above. So we're backing this up with scripture now. Greek word anathen, or heaven. Just as Jesus came from heaven above, we are born from above, not during some time and space event in this dimension, but we come from our Father in heaven and existed with him before the foundation of the world. Amen. She's putting this into a few sentences, what's taken me hours of your time to explain. This email I'm reading. This is what Jesus also states in John 17:16 when he says, they are not of the world, even as I am not of the world. Verse 18 says, as thou hast sent me into the world, even so have I also sent them into the world. We are sent here from heaven. In John 8:23, love John 8. Jesus told the Pharisees, who were also referred to as serpents and scorpions, that they are from beneath. In other words, they're earth dwellers, they're worldly, they're from beneath. Where I am from above, the same wording used in John 3:3 is used in John 8:23. You are of this world as I am, and I am not of this world. In my opinion, and back to the emailer, the serpents have taken the scriptures and twisted the real meaning for the purpose of hiding the truth and enslaving God's elect. The purpose of the institutional church is to enslave and conform God's lambs to an earthly religious system when we do not come out, or when we do not come from this planet or dimension. We cannot be taught to function in or be contained in an earthly temple system. Those that worship must worship in spirit and in truth. Jesus never told us to get born again. He told us to repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand within us. Hold on. Would you let me finish? Jesus made the way back to the paradise lost. He did say a man must be born again to Nicodemus. He said, you must be born again or you can't see the kingdom of God. But you can't get born again. To get born again, in other words, qualifying it, he told us to repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand within us. And that becomes born again, if you will. She's making a distinction between the born again believer that goes up and does, you know, raises their hand and goes for the altar call, and they say, you're born again. But anyway, let me go on with it. You mentioned that God is in our very being, our cells. Exactly. We are the body of Christ. 1 Corinthians 12:12. Interesting. If we become part of the church, we are no longer a body. Your soul gets scalped the minute you walk in the door. Church people do not know how to gather together outside their church organization because they are not connected to the head, Jesus. They are connected to the hive. Either you are part of the body and follow the Lamb wherever he leads, or you're part of the institutional church and go wherever it leads. We will never be a light in the world and expose all the all-seeing eye that controls it if we are tethered to it. And, you know, in terms of more clarification of, you know, get born again, he told Nicodemus, you must be born again, meaning that you must worship in spirit and truth. You must be, you must repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand, which is within us. You must enter into the kingdom, you know, born again, where the scales are taken off your eyes and you see the truth of this whole thing. And I suppose that I don't really give a lot of credence to the whole born again thing, except for the Nicodemus part. You know, when you're born of the Spirit, when you come from darkness to light, it's the metaphor would be born again. But what the born-agains have done is made it this kind of club that's based on carnality, which is nothing of the sort. It's really more that born again means you've entered into the kingdom, that there's been a consummation, i.e. a true baptism of the Spirit. And that is like a birth and a marriage, both rolled into one, and it's done. It's complete. The work at the cross is complete. It's also a mystery to those who can't enter in. But anyway, I thought that was very pertinent to, you know, just very interesting. One person's take on what church really represents. It actually represents the opposite of what it really is. It's a tethering device, a way to say to God's lambs, oh, you're born of the earth. And in fact, most evangelicals have a policy that says life began in the womb when the sperm hit the egg, and then the soul was born then. That's when life began. It's like, that's absurd. That is completely, utterly, 100% illogical. It couldn't have begun then. I mean, there might be some biological process that begins then. But you can't say a soul begins in the womb. That's insane, because souls are eternal. So I don't know what you mean. It's an incongruence. But there's so many lies in the evangelical church, and there's so many lies that they base their Billy Graham stuff on and their Protestant stuff on. And their. I am partial to the Catholics because even though they're just as lost, there's just something about it. It's hard for me to put into words, but I do give them some kind of, you know, like not a pass because... oh, those evil Jesuits stuff, they're running, they're the ones who are doing all this. It's like, yeah, or the Jews or the Zionists, which is it? You know, I'm not even talking about that. I'm talking about something else. There's a spirit there. I'm not sure what I mean, so I'm not going to go any further into it. I don't go there. I mean, I might visit. If I was going to visit a church, I would definitely go to a mass, and I would definitely love to go to confession. I would just love it. I may plan on it. At some point. You know what I also like about the Catholic Church? I like the thinker. I like, you know, Thomas Aquinas, right? And the philosophy. I like the intelligence. And even that priest that was giving me crap out there on the... well, he got so drunk he couldn't really reason. But, I mean, you knew he was smart. He just was exasperated that, you know, somehow, I don't know, maybe he felt impotent or something, you know, that you know, what good is he if you have to become a slave anyway? I mean, so what's the whole point of the being a priest? And, you know, I guess the Catholic Church's position is, well,
You got to be in the world and not of the world. So you bow down to the world to have your living, and then you get an absolution from your priest. And it's kind of like a balancing act. That's why there's so many mafioso that are totally into their priests and to baptizing their kids and the whole Catholic thing. And I understand that, like the Godfather, you know, is really into it. But no, I'm just a fool, you know, because I had my eyes on something else. And the majority of the world just doesn't see it my way. And so that means it's going to be a hard slog for me, especially if I share these ideas or my ideas about the spirit and about, well, you know, I've had really good discussions with Zen people because we are right on the same page on a lot of it. Hindus that are you know, that know Hindu philosophy and history, Buddhists of other stripes besides Zen, we have great deal in common. In terms of, you know, what we never lose sight of the goal here. You know, we don't want to be in spin cycle in the washing machine, okay? In an endless spin and, you know, being used and enslaved in that way. We all agree on that, all these religions, you know, the Zen people, the Hindus, the Buddhists, you know, esoteric Christianity, you know, esoteric Judaism. Well, no, esoteric Judaism is Kabbalah, which is, you know, basically magic and it's earth-dwelling crap. Sorry, you know, not interested in, you know, the tapping into the formula, the magic formula to make it all work out here. Here is not acceptable. Here, this agreed upon reality is nothing but an illusion to begin with. And yes, the Lord wants us to go through it and he created it and I accept it. And the evangelical church wants me to think that God was had his balls tied, was hamstrung, and against his will, somehow man got the better of him and created this. No, sir. That is not the great I am. The mystery of the I am is everything is good despite what you think you see or experience. And love, despite what you think you see or experience. And abundance, despite what you see, think you see or experience. And justice, despite what you think you see or experience. Thus, he is saying, hold your judgment. Let it go. All the things that happen to you, he's designed you to let it go, so it has no grip on you, no hold. And just as an irony about the born-again thing, most of the people I know who say they're born again are in total bondage. It's the most bizarre. I don't understand it. But I know that most of them in the evangelical church are not living their own lives, but somebody else's life. And they're all kind of clones of each other, a hive, if you will. And they are the opposite of what Jesus was telling Nicodemus. The opposite. The opposite of being born in Christ, being, you know, awakened. It is the real fulfillment of what Ezekiel talked about in Ezekiel 13, 16 or whatever, the idea that souls would blossom. It is the true blossoming that the dark side seeks. But all they do is exploit the power of the soul for their nefarious purposes and their greed and lust. Whereas the true blossoming is the wedding feast of the Lord, which occurs within a person, which is a true birth, which is a birth or an opening of consciousness into the eternal, which is the opposite of the blossoming spoken of by the prophet Ezekiel regarding the witches taking over of Jerusalem at that time. And with that, I gotta go. We hope this uploads. Shalom, shalom. May this Sabbath be of a wonderful time for you, and may you have deep, deep rest and healing.